Welcome everybody to my talk about crafting solid state management, a principle-based architecture. I guess everybody knows that state management is really a hard topic, and I'm sure there are more than one person in this room that really screwed it up. So this talk, or not, hands up, who screwed ever up state management in an application? Oh, lots of hands, welcome. Duh. So what this talk should give you is a basic understanding of principles and problems in state management, so the reason why we created those libraries that help us. The basic motivation is based on a quote of Richard Feynman. He's a brilliant teacher, and he said, if you cannot explain something in simple terms, you don't know it yourself. So I spend a lot of time in creating diagrams and other graphics to help you understand it very easily. What I will talk about is what is state, when to care about state, then I will introduce you in many different state management principles, and then I will introduce you in the last part into a meta model where you can apply all the different libraries against it to compare them. My name is Michael. I'm very active in the Angular community, and I do my living out of workshops and consulting. But let's start. Let me ask you a question. What is state? I prepared a list here. It will take 10 seconds to guess what is not state. Well, state can be anything. Anything is state. The important part is, when should we care about this particular state and when not? And here I created some bullet points that help you to decide when you should introduce state management into your application and when not. First is, you have global accessible state, which means you have to share this state in between different parts or components of your application. If you have long-living data, like data that is stored for a long time on your application, you should also manage it in some way. If you need to introduce some caching layer, you can think about state management, and especially if your state has to be reproducible. Also, if you have a huge distributed system, state management libraries help you to organize it in bigger structures. Okay, let's start with state management principles. I came up with four different categories: storage, transformation, updates, and architecture. Let's start with state storage, and here I have four different principles. A separate layer for state, store state as one single piece, store data normalized, and state is serializable. Let me start with the first principle, a separate layer for state. Well, if you start with a very tiny application, most of the time you hold your state in your components, in this consumer block here, this white block on the left. What I really suggest is move this state into a separate layer. If you work on frameworks that provide you a service layer, this is the place where you should put it. This enables you to decouple and separate state management and your component logic. You can reuse it, and of course, you can share state in your application. The second part is store state as one single piece. This is one of my favorite principles or problems, because I messed it up, I guess, more than twice. Huh? You start with an application, you create this service that manages that data, you create another service that manages other data, and in the end, you have a complete chaos. You have no clue where you stored your state and how to get it from. So store state in one single piece helps you to have this single point where you can find all this stuff. It helps you to avoid cyclic dependencies, and of course, it will reduce the data that you store. Store data normalized. So, I guess a lot of you folks know what a NoSQL database is and what a relational database is. In the backend, it is maybe very profitable to introduce NoSQL databases because they are super fast. However, in the frontend, it is a pain to have redundant data. What you do is you will try to normalize your data structures. So this is why I say store data normalized. What it will bring you is it will reduce redundant data. It will also reduce, of course, the store size. And it will move the complexity from your store to your derivation layer. I will talk about the derivation layer later on. The last part of the first chapter is state is serializable. What do I mean with serializable? Any object that you can JSON.stringify, you're in a JavaScript context, huh, is serializable. And you should really, really take care that you only store serializable data. Why is this so important? Well, if you store data serialized, it's not very hard to have your state persistent. It helps you to keep your state reproducible. And you also store no logic in this state. Yeah? No functions, no objects, nothing that could get mutated from outside. Perfect. First chapter done. Let's go on with the second chapter, state transformations. I have, again, four principles. I have state is immutable, functions are pure, restrict concurrent state changes, very important, and state is reproducible. Let's start with the first one. State is immutable. What does immutability mean? So let's think about a function that does some transformation to your input properties, and on the right side, on your right side, on your left side, you have this function that mutates A. So it takes A and then it mutates it and returns the same reference. Compared to the right solution, if you want to change something in A, you create a new object and you return C in this case. Why should you do this? You can produce clean state changes if you have your data immutable. Your state will be consistent, and it also helps you to keep your state reproducible. Next one is functions are pure. Why is this so important? Well, on the left side, you see this question mark, this side effect. And this function not only relies on the two inputs A and B, there is also this question mark that can affect the result of your function. What you should go with is a pure function, a function that only takes the input parameters and nothing else to produce the output. Why is this important? Well, you keep all your logic side effect free, therefore it is very easy to test. Yeah? If you have your functions pure, you can have your state reproducible because your function will always return the same value with the same inputs. So if you take 2 and 2 and you add them, you will always receive 4. And because of this, this is also a very, very cool point where you can introduce some performance optimization. For example, you can cache the result of a pure function. If you pass 2 and 2 to the function and it returns 4, you never ever have to calculate it again because it will always return 4. So this is also a way how you could improve your performance. Restrict concurrent state changes. I'm not sure how many of you know these diagrams. This is a typical diagram for a race condition. You trigger two HTTP requests, 1 and 2, and in one situation, the second HTTP request is arriving earlier than the first. And this leads to broken UI state in your application. What you should take care of is that all your state changes are not concurrent. Why is this important? Again, another puzzle to keep our state reproducible. You get rid of all those unwanted side effects, and I'm not sure how many of you ever ran into the problem of a race condition with HTTP requests. You cannot debug it, yeah? Restrict concurrent state changes because this is the only way how you can debug your application. And now, I often mentioned it, state is reproducible. Reproducible means that any state change that I introduce to my application is revertible, so I can recalculate any single step in those changes. The first diagram shows you that the second change is not revertible compared to the other, to the right diagram, where you can step forward and backward to every single change that you made to the state. This means state is reproducible. Why is reproducibility so important? Well, reproducibility is the foundation for a lot of cool features. For example, time travel debugging is only possible if you have reproducible state. If your state is reproducible, it's very easy for you to implement a redo-undo logic. And it is impossible if your state is not reproducible. And of course, reproducible state is the foundation for optimistic updates. Third chapter, state updates. Why do I need state updates? I have here three different principles. One of my most favorite principles, push-based architecture. Only one direction for data and a separate layer for your derivation. Let's start with push-based architecture. I'm sure everyone is familiar with HTTP requests. If you do an HTTP request, you ask the server for some data, and then the server sends you the data. If you want the latest data, you have to ask again. And now let's compare this to a push-based architecture. With a push-based architecture, you just tell some middleware here, it is called broker, very abstract word, I know. You tell the broker, look, I'm interested in all the users that you store, and whenever any of those users change, please notify me. And then I do nothing but wait for notifications. I don't have to pull the state again and again and again. And this is really, really powerful, especially in state management in the front end. Why? It's super convenient to use. Your data is always fresh. You don't have to care about getting the latest data because you will get the latest data automatically if they change. And, of course, it reduces the complexity in state derivation. Next question, next chapter is one direction for data. On the left side, you see something that I implemented many times in my life when I started with front-end development. Every part of your application can communicate with any other part. And it is very easy to introduce a total mess. It's unmaintainable, you will have so many bugs that you will not find anymore. So what I really, really recommend is introduce one-way data flow. You can do this with some tiny code snippet that is responsible to forward all your comments to the specific state parts or state services. And those services communicate the update to your consumers, and the consumers can, again, only communicate to this mediator code snippet here. If you do this, you will have predictable data flow, you will not be able to introduce some loops, and, of course, this is very, very vital if you want to maintain your application, and I hope you want to. A separate layer for state derivation. First, let me spend a little bit on the name derivation. So what is derivation? I have basically stored some state, and I want to derive, I want to calculate new state from this stored state. What a lot of people do is they put their queries that derive the state from your store into your consumers, into your components. And this is very bad, because if you place those queries in the components, you're not able to reuse those queries. What I would really recommend is take all these queries, put them in a separate file. I call this file or this area derivation layer. And then you're able to reuse your queries. And even better, you can compose them. And this saves a lot of code and a lot of headache. So separate layer for state derivation reduces complexity on the consumer side. It's very easy to extend. And of course, it helps you to keep your code dry. The last chapter is architecture, state management architecture. And here I prepared another 4 principles that should help you to get a clue what is important and what not, what you should consider and what you don't need to consider. The first one is encapsulate events into objects, provide comments or events in a single stream, hide details behind a facet, and my most favorite one, adopt and maintain state is simple. Let's start with encapsulate commands into objects. What does it mean? So instead of having some data and calling another method from another class or service, we do following. We put the data and the command, the thing that should happen, into an object, and then I can send this object into the cloud. I just shoot it out somewhere, and no matter how many people are interested, they can consume this object and do whatever they want. So I decouple my sender from my consumer. What it will bring you is decouples sender from consumer. Your app will be way more scalable. Another reference would be Kamil's talk. I guess it was 3 talks before. He also separated this, which enables him to scale his backends. Then you can also send those objects not only in between your client, but you could go the full circle, so a client-server state management, and you send those objects that are serializable to the server, and then the server pushes you the next event. And it enables you more for more declarative programming. The next one is provide your commands or events in a single stream. If you look on the left side, you see, on the right side, you see a confusing graph, a lot of boxes, a lot of errors. Everyone communicates in another way with our state. And what I really would recommend you is create a channel, and this channel collects all your commands in this one single stream, and this stream forwards the commands to your state. And then it is very easy, no matter if you send a command from the consumer or it is triggered by some middleware, you always send it to the same source. This will help you to reduce the complexity in your architecture. This also enables you to easily connect multiple different remote sources. And it also helps you to keep this one data flow consistent. Next one is hide details behind a facet. I'm not sure how many of you ever heard the word facet. Could I get a quick hands up? Oh, I guess 50, 60%, this is pretty good. Not a lot of people use facets. So what a lot of people do is they directly connect their state management logic with their consumers. And this creates a tight coupling. And it also makes it harder for your UI team to develop the application. Because if you do this, they have to have a lot of knowledge what you're doing in the background. They maybe have to have knowledge about some specific library or some, I don't know, commands. What I really would recommend is everything that is related to state management should be wrapped in a facet, should be wrapped in another class that abstracts away all this internal logic, and you only communicate to this new API that you introduced in the facet. Why could this be so beneficial to you? This enables you to easily replace your state management in the facet. Because all your consumers have no clue what you use to manage the state, it's behind the facet, you can modify it at any point in time. You can replace it, rewrite it, throw it away. They will not realize it. They only communicate to your consumer-facing API that you created in the facet. So no matter what you do, start with a facet. Another cool thing about facets is they black box away all the internal implementation details. Your UI team don't need to know about state management at all. They don't care about it. It's just hidden behind this facet. And because of this, it also simplifies the access to your data or the derivation of your data. The last principle that I present is adopt and maintain state is simple. And this is most beneficial and most important for me. If you take a look on the right side, you see the mathematical explanation for 1 + 1 = 2. How many of you understand it? I guess maybe one or two people, right? How many of you understand the other side, 1 + 1 = 2? A lot more. What do I try to explain with this chart here, with this diagram, with this slide? I want to tell you, if you introduce state management in your application, start simple. Don't take this overhead that you have to explain a very complex problem to a lot of programmers. It will take you weeks before everyone realizes what to do and why to do something. What you should do, or what I would recommend, is start simple. Start with a very simple solution that is very easy to explain to other people, and then, over time, improve it, extend it, replace it with something more complex. Three things that you should do. Scaffold what you can. Use CLI tools or whatever you use to auto-generate as much code as you can. If you can't auto-generate all the code, sit together, discuss the problem, agree on some approach, on some solution for this specific problem, and write the documentation for it. Write a blueprint for this specific problem, and then everyone in your team will implement or will solve the problem in a similar way. So you don't have to reconsider and rethink every time when you open a new component. Now it's solved in that way, now it's solved in this way. So try to unify your solutions. And most importantly, start simple. Don't start with a fully blown Redux solution. Start with a simple one that you can handle, that you can quickly explain to others, and then go on. As a last piece of information, I want to present you some state management meta model. This model should help you to compare your problems, the libraries that you might want to use or not, against it, and then it should help you to make your decision. So this is my meta model, and it consists out of 6 different sections. First, I have the commands, right? Your consumer, your component, your timer, your play button sends a command to your state management and tries to introduce a state change. Then you run into the computation phase, into the computation layer. In this layer, you could do several calculations. For example, this is a very good place to normalize your data. Then you store it. You can store it, of course, in many different ways. You can also store it remote, however you want. And when you want to retrieve the new state, the state runs through the derivation layer. This snippet of code that is maybe composed of many different queries and calculates the state that you are interested in. Before you store data, always try to derive it. So this is the place to put your derivation logic. Whenever an update happens, I want to get notified, and this happens over events. So the difference between events and commands is commands introduce some state change, and events notify you that a state change has happened. So these comments could be done with normal DOM events or could be done over some amazing libraries like RxJS. Will communicate with your consumer. And the last part is the consumer that, of course, consumes your state and displays it. I hope this meta model helps you to compare your library of choice against it and make your decisions if you really need it or not, or how the library is structured. Great. We did a lot of principles. We have this meta model and many other information for you. I hope that you can get something out of it. I hope that you will manage state in a better way now and have more clue why we need those libraries and what the problems behind those libraries are. Thanks for your time, for listening, and if you have any more questions, just approach me after the talk. I'm here for the next 2 days. Thanks.